pretty much anything that the mayor has is a special project that's thrown my way. And off I'm running. I want to let you know, this is not one of those projects. This was very near and dear to his heart, and something that he got it most of the way. Except when it comes to getting papers together, things like that. I want to welcome you all here. It is an incredible sight to see so many folks here. People from Rushville, people who were from Rushville and have come home, and for others who are visiting. So welcome for all of you. I welcome you to what I think will be a memorable and rewarding program for all of us. Some of the most memorable moments of our life, a wedding, a funeral, the birth of a child, often include tears, tears of joy, tears of sadness, and in my case, sometimes tears for reasons I can't quite explain. As I watched the news story last night, the thing that struck me most was a single tear running down the cheek of Carol's sister. To see emotions still that raw after such a long time shows the pain that still exists within her family and within our community. I want you to know the tears of all varieties are welcome today. And that's mainly because I'm a big baby and I'm sitting up front. I want you all to understand that's how I work. There's a sacredness in tears. They're not the mark of weakness, but of power. They speak more eloquently than 10,000 tongues. They are the messengers of overwhelming grief, of deep contrition, and of unspeakable love. I want to share something with you I found while researching for this program. It is an in memoriam from the family that was in the paper 1 year after Carol's passing. To know her was to love her, both her family and friends. And the sweetness of her memory, time can neither dim nor end. Well, here we sit in attendance, roughly 50 years later, a room full of family and friends, two communities standing together, continuing to keep Carol's memory, her story, and her life burning very brightly. Another thing I found interesting was last week I was watching a sitcom, and it wasn't even, I don't think it was that good of a sitcom. But there was a quote that made me think, so much so that I got up, went across the room, and wrote it down, having no idea I'd have a part of the ceremony at the time. But it said, they say you die twice. One time when you take your final breath. And a second time, a bit later, when somebody says your name for the very last time. If you think about it, it's kind of a deep quote. How long will you be gone before your name is not mentioned? Well, today's event is proof positive that her name shall not fade anytime soon. I believe that today's event and the sharing of Carol's story helps remind us all of just how far we have come as a society when speaking about diversity and inclusion. But a quick viewing of the daily news, as I did last night, will remind us there's plenty of work yet to be done. Today, it may seem kind of simple, maybe to other people in the world, but two rural Indiana communities take a stand, put a stake in the ground, and commit to being better. Better today, better tomorrow, and better in the future. At this point, I'd like to introduce Ms. Elaine Stewart, who will immediately be followed by John McCain, who will announce some of the special guests and speakers we have today. Thank you all for coming.
Again, I want to thank everybody for coming today. Special thanks, Mayor Cole, for coming, for being a part of this. As mayors, we get to do a lot of wonderful things. For me, this is probably the pinnacle of those wonderful things. Today and tomorrow, we will be honored to be a part of something long overdue, but no less significant. Today is not about Rushville, and it is not about Martinsville. Today is to remember and honor the gift that was the life of Carol Jenkins Davis. That gift that was senselessly taken in a two-stroke time period. I want to pay special respect to Paul Davis, to Elizabeth Scott, and to the family. I want to thank you for allowing us to pay proper respect for Carol's legacy. I want to thank you for allowing us today in Rushville and tomorrow in Martinsville to do the ceremonies that we will be doing. Losing a family member tests your strength and faith. Losing a child, to me, would be unimaginable. Losing a child the way you lost Carol, for the reason you lost Carol, is incomprehensible. But through your love, your faith, and your patience, you have showed unparalleled commitment to your daughter's memory. If someone were to notice that I am not the most qualified to speak at an event and discuss discrimination and inclusion, they might be right. Because I can't imagine facing discrimination. I can't comprehend a time when we tolerated hatred as a part of our society. I can't imagine facing hatred that was incited only by the color of a person's skin. That you would do that to a person you didn't know and had never met. I can't imagine a time when hatred ran so deep that you would stoop to killing another person. Paul Davis once said, I hope you recognize this, what happened, why it happened, and when it happened would make for an unwilling and unknowing participant in the civil rights movement. And I think he's right. So what allows this family to endure the unendurable? And meeting them, I think it's love, faith, and patience. There is no one who could ever know these people who would ever say that they don't have the most enduring, committed love you've ever seen. I think that looking at this crowd and looking at the reaction of the community, you'd have to say that the community loved Carol. And I can tell you that it's kind of a weird situation, and usually whenever anyone in public office or in public spotlight comes up with an idea, you wait for the pushback that you're going to get. And I am very, very proud to say that there has not been any pushback. Every single person has been overjoyed with the fact that you've done it, and has even made a comment that it's about time. So no one can deny that hate took her. But the love of her family and the love of her community allows her memory to live on. Next will be faith. Through faith in God, they are here today. Through faith in mankind, through that faith, they are able to know that she is in a better place. Through that faith, they have confidence that she looks down upon us today and smiles. And through that faith, they have trusted in God, believing that even when it didn't make sense, something good would come from this. Patience is the final. They'll talk about patience being a virtue. But in order to have patience, you have to have an unbelievable amount of strength. And that patience causes you to be unbelievably vulnerable. In a world of instant gratification, can any of you imagine waiting 12,045 days from the day that your daughter lost her life they have had is unbelievable. And another term I think we have to talk about, which is a term I guess I didn't expect to talk about, was destiny. How many things had to line up for us to be here today? Sandra Chapman, who will speak much more eloquently after I get off of it, took Carol's life on as a mission. She did a cold case story in the news. Now, what are the chances that a person would have listened to that story, remember the story they were told about from a person who at 7 years old, remembers something that happened in Martinsville, and the courage to take that information to the authorities? The authorities looked into it. From that, the person who was the witness actually came forward with information. And she had the fortitude to implicate her father. The city of Rushville, in kind of a different scenario, 2 years ago said, man, community park just it doesn't pop. And we've got to figure out how we reinvent community park. At the same time, we're trying to figure that out, and Carol's name is appearing as maybe that inspiration. Martinsville is working on its own way to maybe remember the event. And oddly enough, theirs hits a little bit of rocky ground. But for some reason, and this I still don't fathom, and he's here today and didn't know we were going to talk about it. Someone posted on Facebook and he tags me. Trust me, when you're a mayor, you don't like getting tagged. But he tagged me and said, this doesn't seem to be working out in Martinsville. Can you help? It's a puzzling thing on Saturday night at about 10 o'clock. I sent a text to a mutual consultant and said, I'm not sure exactly how I can help, but I'll talk to Shannon if you think that would be good. Shannon and I met, had a great conversation, decided we wanted to move forward. And as every strong leader does, I didn't want to call Elizabeth or Paul. So I called Sabrina and said, do you think the family would be interested in these two events happening? And she came back and said, they would be. I think they would be overjoyed. We brought on that summer an intern. His name was Nate, Robert Essay. And his job was to help move this park idea forward. Little did we know that there would be an admiration and a connection with the family that he has thanked us for to this day. He moved the park forward. I had a happen to meet upon an African American sculptor in Missouri on my way to vacation. And we sat and talked, and he talked about what inspires art. And we talked about this project. And he was an artist who was moving back from Arkansas to Chicago. And he got so enthralled with the project that one day he came from Chicago to Rochester to Rushville, Indiana, just to tell us how significant this was. He had never met the Davis family or the Scott family. But for some reason, it connected with him. And it meant enough that he felt it meant enough to people moving forward that we continue this. And then we rolled the idea out to the two communities. And I think I was pretty comfortable. I don't know that Shannon was as comfortable. But I think we're all very pleased in the fact that I think both communities have gone above and beyond in support of this project. So why a park? For us, the park aligned everything. It aligned our goals, our timing, and our resources. In talking to the family, specifically Paul Evans. She was my, that was my personal contact. It was the only one I was about to talk to. She always conveyed how much Carol loved kids. And going forward, where do kids love to go? They love to go to the park. She aspired to be a teacher. And so this gave us an opportunity to educate. Because our goal ultimately was to educate children. So we found, we thought that in a park we would find a teaching moment and a teaching environment. But we knew that the park had to be different. It had to be engaging and interpretive. So why now? I was brought up in a household that said it's never too late to do the right thing. And that's what we're doing. We have a blank canvas in a park that we willingly look for inspiration. And Carol, and the opportunity to remember her life and educate future generations, is that inspiration and alignment. So what will that park look like? You look at the easels on each side of me. You'll have mounding, landscaping, reading and reflection areas, art, and sculpture. Gathering areas and trails to engage you, and invite you through the community gardens and through the community orchard. And what's that walking trail look like? There'll be one with interpretive storytelling stations throughout that will give you insight into Carol's life, to the time she lived in, where we were then, and where we aspire to be. And will the park be completed? It will not happen overnight. We will ask for that word we talked about earlier, patience. But we will break it down into phases. Our goal will be to complete the park in 2020. But I will commit to you that every year I'm in office, I will commit budget, time, and resources to completing the vision of that park. So we kind of touched on it, but I want to be very specific. What is the goal of the park? As you enter the park, you'll be greeted by a sign bigger than that one, but looking like that one, that hangs over there on our blue. And what we're hoping for is two things. We hope for two questions. We hope that people ask, who was Carol Jenkins Davis? And then we want them to ask, why was the park named her honor? Because if they ask that question, it will open the door to the world of education. My hope is that parents, teachers, use the park as a subtle way to teach children in their formative years. You might ask yourself, can this really happen? And I think today is evidence that it can happen. And I will call out one person in the room as evidence of how it can happen, and that's my son, who is an eighth grader, who asked me to be here. Because since the inception of this idea to now, there's been a lot of conversation at home about the park, about the design of the park, which has allowed us to have countless conversations about Carol Davis, about her life, about injustices, about how we should treat each other. And if we do this right, we will avoid something he talked about. So it is true, sometimes you learn something from your kids. We were out Sunday, because I had to call Paul back because I forgot what section where a tombstone was. And we're out walking through the cemetery, looking, and my son said, cemeteries are sad. And I said, why? And he said, because they're just a bunch of stones with names on them and dates on them. But they don't tell you anything about who's buried here. They don't tell you the person's story. They don't tell you what they did in their life. They don't tell you if they were significant. If we do this right, That's something we won't have to worry about with Carol. So, today does not remove the pain of the family. It does not right the wrongs. It does not bring Carol back. It doesn't complete the hopes and dreams of her life. But I think it does inspire us to start a new chapter. One where we behave in a different manner. An evolution through education. So as I leave the podium today, I want to reemphasize to Carol's parents, to her family, and to all in attendance, what our mission, what the mission of the park, and what our theme of the day is. And that is, Carol's life had value. Her story will live on as an opportunity to teach future generations the value of inclusion and diversity. Thank you to the family for allowing me, the Rush County and Rushville community, the Martinsville community, to celebrate Carol and her life here.
Lots of integrity and pride led their family into into a courtroom to see for the first time charges filed in their daughter's case, that I decided to write The Girl in the Yellow Scarf. This book title came from Shirley Richmond McQueen, the woman who came forward to say she witnessed the crime as a 7-year-old little girl in the back seat of her own father's car. In her childlike eyes, Carol's brown and gold paisley print scarf appeared yellow under the streetlights of that rainy night on September 16, 1968. Even though Shirley's memory was a brief encounter, she speaks about the deep, deep impact Carol had on her life in a few excerpts of The Girl in the Yellow Scarf. I'm going to read a couple of them for you. My attention was captured by the caramel-colored figurines prominently displayed throughout Shirley's neat and modest living room. Each one of the figurines was adorned with angelic wings, halos of gold, and an expression of the peace that Shirley was still asking God for each day. At first, it seemed odd to me, a middle-aged white lady from the south side of Indianapolis, where dark faces like mine were scarce, filling her home with of hand-painted African-American angels. But the more Shirley talked to me, I realized the heavenly symbols reflected the deep emotional connection she felt with Carol Jenkins. In Shirley's own words, she said, "I can never say I understand her tragedy. I can say I have mourned Carol my whole life, not knowing her name most of it. Forever I have flashes of yellow, the rain, the drive. I do not think I will ever stop hurting for Carol. Looking back, it seems as though when I was completely lost, Carol helped me to get through. I believe a part of her spirit has always been with me. Because even in the darkest and worst of times, God is always with us and sending his angels and peace to us in many forms." That was Shirley McQueen. Now, here we all are, here in this place, nearly 50 years later. And like Shirley, we are witnesses that Carol's radiant spirit still lives on. I believe for many of us, Carol's life represented the promise of a bright future in a world that was just beginning to open up so many possibilities. In 1968, she was ready to step out the bricks and barriers and set the bar a little higher for what women and what minorities could achieve. You know, Carol had options. She was beautiful. She could have been a model if she wanted to, probably. She had brains and wanted to be an educator, a teacher of our children, and she was bold. What I mean by that is that Carol did not believe in discriminatory limits. Instead, she believed the better part of us would rise up to overshadow small-minded forces that refused to embrace diversity and progressive change. From what I've learned about Carol, it had to be her belief and hope in the greater good that convinced her to face the unknown and possibly even her worst fears as she kept walking. The night trouble crossed her path. In one word, I would describe her as courageous. Today, that is the spirit that we will all remember when we think about Carol Jenkins. The rededication of this park is a shining moment for the city of Rushville. It really is. It is truly a beautiful, bright, and bold gesture holding true to Carol's memory. Think about it. A beautiful landmark where anyone, and I mean anyone, can come and enjoy a place of peace. A place where visionaries can dream about the future. A place where children can play and interact, and as the mayor has said, even learn some lessons there, without the weight of divisiveness that adults too often seem to interject. Just think about what communities recently have been through, some communities, I should say, like Charlottesville, who have endured chaos, hate-filled speech, and violence. And there, a young woman lost her life, too. But you and your community today have chosen to take a stand to bring people together around the memory of a young woman whose life channels such a different message. Today I join you in saying this is the time for those of us who say we love God, who say we love our country, who say we love our community, to bridge the gaps. Reach out to understand those you don't know. And to take a stand to value one another at the very basic level. Sometimes that might mean a personal stand to what you can be as a voice of reason or even simply compassion. Other times it's a big, bigger decision, like the one Shirley and her sister-in-law had to make when they decided it was time to tell the secret. You never know who needs your courage to speak up. While this kind-hearted family that you all clearly love so much has been able to get some information, there is still a missing piece for them today. The identity of the accomplice in Carol's death is missing. It's a critical piece, and we still hope that someone, somewhere, will soon dare to share that too. I've seen time and time again over my career that when one person does what they can to fulfill their role, oftentimes it prompts someone else to step forward and do the same. Let this sink in. The mayor already talked about it a little bit, but this mayor and the city's decision has already had an impact through a special partnership with the mayor of Martinsville, Mayor Cole. The city where Carol lost her life, we all know it well. For years, Martinsville has wrestled with its reputation. And we have to know that mainly that was because of what happened to Carol so long ago. But there have been other factors too. Don and Norma Neal were the last couple to see Carol alive in Martinsville. And a couple of years ago, they had this big dream. They wanted to create a memorial for Carol there in Martinsville, in the heart of the town. But despite their best efforts, they met resistance. It didn't happen. And that was the article I think that the mayor was tagged in. Now, after years of failed attempts, the city of Martinsville will dedicate a memorial to Carol Jenkins. And that is a testament to new ways of thinking between two mayors who decided to come together and do something different. And that should be praised. We can never know the full extent of what we missed not having Carol's physical presence here with us. But I believe we all can be better because of her legacy. I too am reminded of something that you, Paul Davis, said more than a decade ago. It's very simple. Unfortunately, sometimes we miss it. He said, it's not about color. It's about what a person has in their heart. On this day, Mayor Pavey, you and the city of Rushville and your community can say, you are a collection of God's people who believes in honoring a bright light who lived among you and brought joy to so many around her. And you can say you will stand in history as a community who cared and vowed to never forget. And tomorrow, the same things will be done in Martinsville. Congratulations to the family and to all of you. Thank you.
first, I want to give honor to God, who's the head of our lives, and I think that he allowed me to get here from Kansas City safely. My name is Pat, and I grew up here. I left in 1968. Carol was our oldest sister, and my parents still are. On behalf of our entire family, I would like to thank the mayor, all the special guests, and even the 1965 people. That's awesome. Thank you so much for being here and dedicating the park in honor of our sister who was taken from us way too soon. For those of you that don't know us, and you probably do know about Carol's family, it's been in the paper and on the internet and everything, but she was our beautiful oldest sister who had such a loving and caring heart. But she was only 21 years old, just beginning her adult life. But that ended on the night of September 16, 1968. And for those of you that don't know, but you do now because of everybody, what they said, but for those of you that don't know what happened, Carol and her friend, and I am so happy to see her friend here today, and I want her to stand up because she's on the front. And that's Paul. Paul Ferrario. Yes, but she was with her friend and a couple other employees that they were starting a new career with a company that sold encyclopedias door to door. Initially, they were supposed to start selling in Vincennes, Indiana, but somehow they ended up in Martinsville, Indiana. Upon their arrival, they did split up and they began canvassing the neighborhoods trying to sell their encyclopedias. But as we all know, Carol never met up with her friends again because later that night, in one particular neighborhood, two men attacked her from behind and tragically took her life, all because of the color of her skin. Even though justice has not been accomplished in this case yet, perhaps today is a call to unity will be declared today by naming the park after her. But we as a people should never stop fighting for justice. This happened 49 years ago and we're still dealing with this today. You know, I mean, even today the country is struggling with racial injustices, police brutality, unfair sentencing, and still unsolved deaths. Our prayer is that all of the children in this community and their families will always feel safe when they come to this park, the Carol Jenkins Davis Community Park, and won't have to worry anymore about being harassed by anybody because of their race, their gender, their nationality, or any religious belief. It is up to the citizens of Rushville, Indiana to make sure that this park will always represent a place of safety, peace, unity, good community relations, and understanding and respecting of all races. We have to learn to love and respect one another. So on behalf of Carol, our entire family, and also our brother, Larry Davis, who a lot of you knew. I know he's looking down upon us, and he is happy and excited that you guys have decided to name your park the Carol Jenkins Davis Community Park. And I know that he is really, really excited about his community. I'm proud of you guys for stepping up and giving Carol's own. So again, on behalf of the family, I just want to thank you for this opportunity and that this will be a great history lesson for the future. So thank you again. And may God continue to bless each and every one of us.
Carol just had too much luck. Had
The day came when she was taken from me for no reason. I couldn't understand why someone would want to hurt such a beautiful young lady. She was so beautiful and young and had such a great life ahead of her. She would do anything for anybody. I guess that's why I was so close to Fred, because he was the next best thing to my sister Carol. He was a beautiful man too. I know my sister's in heaven. I have seen her. I know that Fred and her are together again, riding around in that 57 ship, talking about the good old days and saying that that Robert turned out to be a good man. I always wondered what her children would have been like. I'm sure that they would have had been great kids. She'll always be in my heart, and I'll never stop missing her. I'll always love you forever, Carol. I look forward to seeing you one day. I know this is not the way you want things to end in your life, but God had a plan for you and a plan for us. He had us weather the storm and learn to lean on Him and trust in Him. I hope that we can be a strong family again like we used to be. God will be pleased. God, will you please bless this family and let us not suffer anymore. Let us heal. In your name, I pray. Amen. Amen.
HWC, Corey Bam for the park's final layout. The Rush County Community Foundation recognized two individuals, Carol and Rita Yeager, who recommended a grant from their mother's fund, the Rita Yeager Memorial Act Grant Fund, that was made possible to help with the orchard. Green Signs, I'd like to thank Sean and Kevin, Darren McGowan, the graphic design and photography, Parkport Outlines, Feemore Foods. I'd like to thank Eric Hayes for the Rushville High School Community Service, Thurston Owens for the Parks Department, the Street Department, the media outlets, and the RCHS video class that covered this event to continue to help tell Carol's story, Barrett Law Office for the use of this wonderful building, Sandra Chapman for never giving up on Carol, the family, or the story, and all who have aided in making today happen. And we have decided to dedicate and plant a tree in honor of Carol, which is the one over here in the corner. And we chose an October glory because it will have reddish yellow leaves, with the yellow signifying the yellow scarf, which was synonymous with Carol in her final hours. Due to inclement weather, we will not be planting the tree today, but instead would like to send home some memoirs that contain some leaves from the tree for the family to take home with them. And at this time, I'd like to invite the mayors and the family over to the tree for a few moments, a few pictures, and would like to thank all of you for coming. Have safe travels. Good afternoon.